أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الله نور السماوات والأرض مثل نوره كمشكاة مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح المصباح في زجاجة الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو لم تمسسه نار نور على نور يهدي الله لنور ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم في بيوت أذن الله ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه يسبح له فيها بالغدو ولا صال رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار ليجزيهم الله يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار ليجزيهم الله أحسن ما عملوا ليجزيهم الله أحسن ما عملوا ويزيدهم من فضله والله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب صدق الله العظيم.
ثنيات الوداع وجب الشكر علينا مدى
من ثنيات Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina wa Habibina Rasulillah wa alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. I now declare the first Zaytuna College commencement begun. Please be seated. Alhamdulillah, first of all, I'd like to welcome everybody on behalf of Zaytuna College's students, staff, and faculty, our guests. This is your college. Secondly, I have a difficult task at hand, that of thanking so many people for helping us realize this day. I can't thank everybody by name, as we would be here for another 4 years before I'd finish. So suffice it to say, you know who you are, but more importantly, God knows who you are. I have to thank my Lord and Creator first and foremost for the gift of the mind, the gift of consciousness itself, the ability to learn what is necessary to know this world and prepare for the next. I want to thank a few people because this is a momentous moment for us. I want to thank Sayyid Hisham al-Alusi, who several years ago came to me with the idea of incorporating Zaytuna Institute, and with my wife Liliana and Sayyid Hisham and myself, we started the Zaytuna Institute. And so I really, my great appreciation to him for all of his support over the years. To Freydoun Mujaddidi, who first came to me with the idea of starting the Islamic Studies School in Hayward, California, where we began to study these texts that I felt were so important for Muslims to learn. And then an immense amount of gratitude goes to Imam Zaid Shakir, who in many ways we're really here because of his indefatigable energy, his tirelessness, the commitment that he made to the first pilot program, which almost single-handedly helped 4 years of study for the students that graduated from the initial pilot program and showed us really that this was possible. This was something that we could do. And from that idea came the idea of a liberal arts college for Muslims in the United States. The idea of bringing the best of these two worlds together to help young minds develop into caring critical thinkers, a creative minority that would set out to make a mark on the world for the better. And also I want to extend thanks for Sister Marianne Farina, who came down from the hill, what's known as the Holy Hill. We affectionately call it the Hill, which is a consortium of religious colleges next to the University of California at Berkeley. She came and visited us at the Institute over a decade ago and planted in Dr. Hatem Bazian, who we also owe an immense amount of gratitude toward, planted in our minds the idea of bringing Zaytuna up onto the hill. Little did we know that that would ever happen. And I told her if she's ever beatified by the church, I'd testify to one of her miracles. They need four. Card tricks don't count. I want to thank all of the volunteers through the years who believed in this mission and add to the many workers who always went above and beyond because they had to, not because they had to, but because they knew how important this project was to fulfill. Endless hours, tireless nights, poring over the problems of this college with love and sweat and sometimes tears. Haroon Sellers, whose positive attitude has always reminded us at Zaytuna that outlook is a condition, not of circumstance, but of choice. Safir, Zakaria, Aisha, Sayyid Mubin, I could go on, but as I said, God knows who you all are. To all the donors whose hard-earned money flowed freely from their pockets, believing and trusting that we would do our best to be sound stewards of their efforts, I want to thank the faculty for working so hard to give these students the best of their time and experience, for their rigor and regard, for the trust given them. I want to thank all of my teachers, first and foremost, Shaykh Abdallah Bin Bayyah, who came all the way across the world, really, for being a guide for me, and for his love of knowledge, his deep and profound service to this faith, for his spirit and prophetic concern for the well-being of our community, both Muslims and others, for his devotion to peace in our time. I want to thank Sayyid Naqib al-Attas, who we invited but was unable to come, for his writings that, in which he revealed, I think, the central crises of the Muslim world, a crisis of knowledge and the loss of adab, which is an untranslatable word and yet the foundation of our faith. Our Prophet ﷺ said, "Adabni Rabbi fa ahsana ta'dibi." My Lord nurtured and educated me, and what a beautiful and excellent education he gave me. To Dr. Nasr, who I think restored the immediacy of metaphysics and the disastrous result of its neglect to our forefront. Really one of the giants in the world of ideas. Just to have these two teachers here is, I think, for us very auspicious and extraordinary. I want to thank our board for their incredible hard work and endeavors, those who were with us from the start and those who came later. I want to also really thank the staff who I think have just worked so incredibly hard, all of them. I also want to thank, and this is really about gratitude today, so I want to thank the scholars of Mauritania for keeping this tradition of liberal arts alive in the Muslim world and showing me that the tradition of my own father, who was a liberal arts student and professor, was not a Western tradition, but an Abrahamic one, shared by Muslims, Jews, and Christians, and so sorely needed in this time. At the head of them, I really want to thank my teacher, Marab Tarhaj, a master of the language arts of grammar, logic, and rhetoric, who revived the deep study of grammar in his own part of Mauritania with his magisterial commentary on the Alfiya of Ibn Malik, one of the great texts of Arabic grammar, reminding us that grammar matters. Grammar matters. That meaning matters, that words matter. That is essentially what makes us human, is words. And finally, I want to thank the students, all 49 of them, but especially these 9 that are graduating today, reminding you that when UC Berkeley, which now has over 35,000 students, when UC Berkeley started, their first graduating class was 12 students. They called them the 12 apostles. So we have 9. And I want to thank them for trusting us, for caring enough to forge through 4 years of hard work. All of them, in my mind, are graduating with distinction and honor, all of them. They forged through an incredible hard work, and that they're sitting here with us today is a testimony of that incredible hard work, despite the many obstacles, the false starts, our own incompetence at times. These students persevered, and today we're honoring you, just as you honored us 4 years ago when you walked through our doors. It's a better program today because of these students. You helped us to find out what worked and what didn't, and while that is an ongoing process, we are far closer to our goal because of these students. We'll all miss them, and I will miss them. I've come to know and respect you as fine people as well as fine students. Rashida, who I wish we could take credit for her gift as a poet, but she came to us as an accomplished poet already. Faatimah, whose intelligence is going to make its mark wherever it's felt. Lena, whose purity and goodness is coupled with a first-rate mind. Harun, who fell in love with learning for learning's sake, and whose yearning I'm sure will take him to distant places and back to these shores with treasures, no doubt. Chris, whose taciturn temperament conceals seriousness and a first-rate intellect and will be of great service to our community, of that I'm certain. Reem, whose precision and excellence always made for good reading when papers were due. Mahassan, a diamond, not in the rough, but finely cut. Jamie, who has shown us such fortitude, really in the face of incredible adversity, struck by a very, very debilitating accident, and yet he's here with us today because of that incredible heart that he's shown to Mehdi, who came already trained as a lawyer, and after two years, is not suing us, so I think we did our job. Also a really wonderful spirit that came into our midst. This is a great day for us, but more importantly, it's a great day for all of you because of your hard work. All of you brought us here, we're proud of you, and we expect great things from you. And so I want to conclude with a few remarks about why I feel this endeavor is so important. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's recorded that he said, "Innakum qad asbahtum fi zamanin kathirun fuqaha'uhu, qalilun khutaba'uhu, kathirun mu'tuhu, qalilun su'aluhu, al-amalu fihi khayrun min al-ilm. Wa sayati zamanun qalilun fuqaha'uhu, kathirun khutaba'uhu, al-ilmu fihi khayrun min al-amal." The hadith states that you are in a time, meaning the companions, are in a time where there are many learned people in this religion that truly understand the religion. There are few orators. Those giving are much more than those asking. Action in this time is better than knowledge. But there will come a time when the fuqaha, those who understand this faith, are few and the orators will be many. Many will be asking and few will be giving. And in that time, knowledge will be greater than action. The crises that we have, this morning I was having breakfast and the man that served us, I knew that he was probably from Senegal, so I asked him, "Are you from Senegal?" His jaw dropped, because for a white person in America to know a Senegalese, that always shocks them. And then I said, "Are you Wolof?" So he was even more shocked. He said, "Yes." And then I said, "I studied in Mauritania," and he said, "That's true Islam." He said, "All of our teachers studied there." He said, "All these problems today are because people don't know what Islam is." This is a man who's working as a waiter in a restaurant. His knowledge is basically at the essence of the problem, that we have a crisis of knowledge. I want to mention something that one of our greatest scholars said. Imam al-Shatibi, who wrote the magisterial work Al-Muwafaqat, said in that book, there is a report in a hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said, "The best of generations is my generation, and then comes those who follow them, and then those who follow them." Imam al-Shatibi says, "In this tradition, there's an indication that the status of each following generation with respect to what went before it will be like this. It is related from the Prophet that he said, 'At the beginning of your religion will be prophethood and mercy. Prophethood and mercy, followed by domination and mercy. And then by domination and coercion, and then by cruel domination.'" This is, and then Imam Shatibi says, "This is not possible unless good becomes scarce, when evil competes with it, gradually gaining ground. What we are discussing is included under this absolute meaning, the creeping villainy that Kierkegaard mentions, that is so undiscernible when it first emerges and yet continues to creep until villainy becomes a norm." He says, "There is no year that is followed except by one that is more evil. I did not say that it rained more in the previous year, or that there was more fertility in one year than the other, or that one ruler was better in one year compared to another. Rather, I mean by it the disappearance of the best among you, the disappearance of your scholars. Finally, a group will rise up who will settle things according to their personal views, thus attempting to demolish Islam and defiling it." In another hadith, the Prophet said, "Knowledge will be snatched away by the taking away of scholars along with their knowledge, leaving behind ignorant people who will be asked to settle matters, and they will do so on the basis of their personal views, thus being misguided and misguiding others. The Prophet ﷺ said, Islam began as a strange thing, and it will revert to the estrangement with which it began. Blessed be the strangers. It was said, who are those strangers, O Messenger of God? And he said, ﷺ, they will be the strangers from all the various clans. In one narration, they said, they are those who set matters right when things go wrong with the people. It is related that Abu Idris al-Khawlani said, Islam is bare with the people attached to it, but it will be torn away thread by thread. In other words, Islam is a naked thing, and it's the beauty of the people that adorn its nakedness. If you strip away those beautiful people, you leave it naked. We're living in a time where people associate Boko Haram with Islam. We're living at a time when people don't think of Imam al-Ghazali or Fakhruddin al-Razi or all of these great giants that went before us. They think of ignorant people, and many people believe that this is Islam. And that's why we're here. That's what this is about. This is about restoring the centrality of knowledge to our religion. The centrality of knowledge to our religion. There is a historian who wrote a book recently, Why the West Won. And he said in that book, the most fundamental key to the rise of Western civilization has been the dedication of so many of its most brilliant minds to the pursuit of knowledge, not to illumination, not to enlightenment, not to wisdom, but to knowledge. And the basis for this commitment to knowledge was their Christian commitment to theology. This holds immense truth to it, but the difference is that they lost their theology. Their knowledge was divorced from illumination, from wisdom, and so now technology is literally threatening us. If you have been following what's in store for us with virtual worlds being created, we have to restore sanity to knowledge. And this will take an immense effort, and this Zaytuna College is one small piece in that effort. And I close with a hadith from Al-Hakim, some consider it to be Hassan, a good hadith, that Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, عليك بالعلم فإن العلم خليل المؤمن والحلم وزيره والعقل دليله والعمل قيمه والرفق أبوه واللين أخوه والصبر أمير جنوده. Seek knowledge, for it is the intimate friend of the believer. Forbearance is the minister of knowledge. Intellect is its guide. Action is its pivot. Benevolent character its father. Gentleness its brother. And patience is the general of its armies. I'm very honored to be here today with these students, and I really wish them the best of success. We're expecting great things from all of them. Alhamdulillah. I feel incredibly honored to bring Shaykh Abdallah Bin Bayyah, who I think is truly one of the greatest living scholars that we have today. And this is not my personal opinion, but it's the opinion of many, many of some of the top scholars in the world today. He's recognized as being a renewer of usul al-fiqh. He's a master of the Islamic sciences. His youth was spent memorizing and mastering the great texts of Islam. He learned the 10 variants of the Quran by heart. He mastered the poetry of the Jahili Arabs. He mastered the Arabic language. He mastered the science of tafsir, hadith. And his concern over the last years has really been restoring the concept of sanity in fiqh, of bringing sanity back to fiqh by reviving what Imam al-Ghazali considered to be 9/10 of knowledge, which is understanding how to apply the particulars, the universals of our tradition in the particulars of the time. And this is a big knowledge. This is a deep knowledge. It's going to take an incredible amount of work for people to learn and absorb this knowledge. And we hope that our students, inshallah, will be part of that. So I want to welcome him now, and I'll translate for him, inshallah. So it's my great honor to welcome Shaykh Abdallah Bin Bayyah, Al-Allama.
الله. يا الله فيها شيء سهل
نعم وهم يسمعون
يسمعون الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الملك القهار الغفار الحمد لله الذي يخلق ما يشاء ويختار الحمد لله على طول العمر وتجديد الآثار والصلاة والسلام على صفوة الأخيار سيدنا محمد نور الأنوار وأنباع الأسرار وعلى آله الأطهار وصحابته الأبرار ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد أيها الإخوة أخي وحبيبي شيخ حمزة يوسف وأيها الإخوة الأفاضل كل باسمه وشميل واسمه أيها الأحبة جميعا أحييكم بتحية الإسلام السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته في بداية مجالسنا استنشد بعون الله تعالى وبإلهامه وتوفيقه فنبدأ بالذكر لنقول جميعا لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عسى ربنا أن يجدنا ويعيننا بما جاء في الحديث ما قعد قوم يذكرون الله إلا حفته الملائكة وغشيتهم الرحمة ونزلت عليهم السكينة وذكرهم الله فيمن عنده فنسأله سبحانه وتعالى أن يبسط علينا من البركات والرحمة والفضل كما جاء في الحديث الآخر إخواني أخواتي إخواني الأفاضل أخواتي الفضليات أنتم إخوتي في الله ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعلنا من المتحابين في وجهه ومن المتحابين في الله ولوجه الله سأتحدث باختصار عن ذكريات، سأتحدث عن عنوان، سأتحدث عن برهان، سأتحدث عن بيان. هذه أربع نقاط سريعة. أما الذكريات فقبل 14 سنة أو 15، كنا هنا في بدايات فكرة الزيتونة، كنا في هاي ورد أو ما يطيب للشيخ حمزة أن يسميه بحي الورد، في مباني مؤقتة، في دراسة غير منتظمة، وبعد 7 سنوات نصل إلى عام فيه يغاث الناس وفيه يعصرون. فها هي الأفكار تنبت في حديقة الإرادات والإصرار، تنبت شجرة طيبا مباركا تلوح في مذابح الثمار، تلك الثمار التي أينعت والتي نقطفها اليوم، هي ثمار شجرة مباركة هو بان الحسن، هو عنوان يحمل مضمونا عظيما. لقد سمعنا القائل قبل قليل يقرأ الآيات المباركات في سورة النور، وهي آيات لا يتسع المقام لشرحها، بل لا تتسع كل مقامات الدنيا
لتفسيرها
وتأويلها. لكن لعلنا نتوقف عند الزيتونة، زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية. يقول الكثير من المفسرين ومنهم الخازن في لباب التأويل إن النفي في قوله تعالى لا شرقية ولا غربية أي هو نفي قصر وحصر، وليس نفي نسبة وإضافة. طبعاً ترجمته مني، هي زيتونة شرقية وغربية، أي لا شرقية فقط ولا غربية فقط، لأنها ليست في خبت من الأرض، لا تتنسم الهواء ولا تتلقى أنوار الشمس، وليست في مضحات من الأرض، في كل وقتها هي في الشمس، تصيبها الشمس ويصيبها الظل، فهي تجمع مزايا فضائل الشرق ومزايا الغرب، فلا هي شرقية تتضرر بالحر، ولا هي غربية تتضرر بالقر، ما ذكر عن ابن عباس. زيتونتنا هذه أن نرجو لها أن تكون مثل هذه الزيتونة، هي لا شرقية ولا غربية، هي شرقية غربية، تأخذ أفضل ما في الشرق وتنفتح لمزايا خير ما في الغرب، هي الوسط، هي الواسطة. هذه الزيتونة تشير عندي إلى حلف الفضول، حلف الفضول بين الأشخاص وبين ذوي النوايا الحسنة للمشاركة في الخير والمساعدة في العدل، لكن حلف الفضول هنا بالإضافة إلى العلاقات مع الأشخاص الماديين هو حلف فضول مع الأفكار أيضا. إن برامج كلية الزيتونة يبين هذا الحلف الجديد، وأن حلف الفضول ليس فقط بين أشخاص وإنما بين أفكار أيضا، هو حوار بين الأفكار، تعاون بين الأفكار، اختيار للأفكار لتتزاوج وتتلاقح لتصوغ في النهاية فكرا إنسانيا يضل الجميع ويسعف الجميع. تلك هي الزيتونة التي في الحقيقة شجرة ثمرها طعام وزيتها إدام، وأيضاً هي نور يستعمل في المصابيح لينير القلوب وينير الدروب. هذه المعاني تداعت في ذهني في هذا العنوان شجرة، الزيتونة ولهذا في منهجي القائمين على هذه الزيتونة وليسمح لي إخوة أن لا أذكر جميع الأسماء، عندي حبيبي الصفي وأخي الزكي حبيبي شيخ حمزة وأخي شيخ زيد شيخ حاتم وغيرهم، هؤلاء يمثلون هذا المنهج، المنهج الإنساني المتصالح المتسامح الذي لا يستبعد أحدا ولا يستنكف عن الاستفادة من أي كان. هذا هو ما سميته بحلف الفضول مع جميع ذوي النوايا الحسنة، مع أولي بقية، فلولا كان من القرون من قبلكم أولو بقية ينهون عن الفساد في الأرض. ذلك هو العنوان، عنوان جميل، زيتونة في الغرب لكنها تحمل مضامين الفضيلة من الشرق وتحمل مضمون العمل من الغرب أيضا. أما البرهان فهل تترجم أم أستمع؟
نعم أترجم بسم الله. The Sheikh began by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and also blessings upon our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the light of lights, and upon his pure family and his righteous companions. He said to all of you, beloved people, I greet you with the greeting of Islam, which is a greeting of peace. Peace be upon you. And he said, I ask help from God to say what's appropriate and ask for his inspiration. I want to begin by remembering God and saying, La ilaha illallah, there's no God but the one true God, and Muhammad is his messenger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, three times he said that, hoping, he said that we would go, that this gathering would fall under the category of the hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no group of people come together and they mention God except a mercy descends upon them, the angels encompass them, a tranquility descends upon their hearts, and God mentions them in a better gathering. He said, I'm going to speak briefly about four things. The first is some recollections. The second is the name, and then the proof, and then the explanation. And so he said, before 14 years, he came here to this same place, the Bay Area, visiting, and he said, at that time, Zaytuna was really an idea in our minds. He said there was a small school in what we used to call Hayward, meaning the place of the roses in Hayward. And he said he came there and he found a place where teaching was going on, but it wasn't really, it wasn't organized in the way that you would find or institutionalized in that way. And he said, but then he, after 7 years, another thing emerged, he saw emerge. And now he's seeing, after 14 years coming back, really the fruits of a tree that was planted. And I wish I could do his Arabic justice. It was extremely, just rhetorically beautiful. But he said that it's a fruit that's come to fruition. And this is what we're witnessing today. It's a blessed fruit from a blessed tree. And so he wants to talk about the name itself, the unwan, the title, what we're calling it. And he said, Zaytuna is a... You heard in the earlier, when the Quran was recited, it mentioned the tree of Zaytuna, which is a blessed tree. And he said that in the Quran, it says that this tree is neither of the east nor of the west. And that negation is a certain type of negation. Khazan and other mufassirun said that the negation here, because you have a negation which limits, and then a negation which is an addendum or adds to it. So it's, and he said that this one was the type of negation that was not saying it's not of the east or of the west, but it means neither of the east nor of the west, but of both. And he said this is one opinion about that verse, that the reason that it's said that it's neither of the east or the west is because the Zaytuna tree is a tree that grows in difficult climates. It can grow in the shade, it can grow in the sun, it can be in extreme climates, and it can be in moderate climates. It has qualities that you don't find in other trees. And he said that what we're told is that it has benefits of both the east and the west. And he said that, in other words, it's a middle type of tree. It has a moderate nature. And he said that this reminded him of the alliance of virtue, which was an alliance that happened before the Prophet ﷺ was given the message. And he said the alliance of virtue was an agreement amongst these clans that they would ally with one another to support goodness and virtue. But he said you can also have an alliance of virtue of the ideas, an alliance of virtue of the mind, not just of moral behavior, but of intellectual and spiritual alliance, where you ally in your understandings. And he said that Zaytuna, that this is what his hope, is that this is really a place where it has a human foundation, where all peoples can be shaded in that tree, this intellectual tree of Zaytuna, that it's not limited to the East or the West. And he said, if you look at the tree also, it's a tree that bears a fruit, but from that fruit, which is eaten as a fruit, also comes an oil. So it's both a food and a dressing. It's a food and a condiment. And so he said that, and then even more wondrous, it's a source of light. So it's an oil that actually traditionally lighted the lamps of people in their homes. And he said it's also a universal sign of peace, that we use the Zaytuna, the olive branch, as a sign of peace. And he said, these really represent to me what this college is about. And he said that the three people that he knows that founded this college, myself, his beloved Imam Zaid, and Dr. Hatem, he said that these people, in his estimation, embody open-mindedness and tolerance, embody the virtues of this tree. And he said that they also are people, the remnants of a bypass time, a more virtuous time, and this is what the Quran calls ulu baqiyya. And the Quran says in Surah Hud that had there been more people from previous generations that were destroyed, had there been more people that reminded people, reminding them not to do corruption or evil. So this is the name, this is what the name means. It has the virtues of both the East and the West. It has the virtues of the East and the hopes of the West.
الحضور بين الأفكار.
نعم. بينت هذا نعم.
الأشخاص والأفكار.
نعم.
أما البرهان. البرهان في الشريعة وفي المنطق. في المنطق هو أقوى الحجج. أجلها البرهان أجل ما يقدمه الإنسان ليقنع الآخرين هو أن يقدم برهانا ولهذا جاء في القرآن الكريم قد جاءكم برهان من ربكم وجاء فيه قل هاتوا برهانكم إن كنتم صادقين وجاء في الحديث صدقته برهان أي أنها تبرهن على إيمان صاحبها حين يعطي ماله في غير مقابل إلا ابتغاء وجه الله البرهان هنا هو على جملة من الدعاوى الدعوة الأولى هي أن الإسلام يمثل مشكلة فأنتم قدمتم البرهان على أن الإسلام يمثل حلا إن شاء الله سأختصر حسب الإمكان البرهان أيضاً أنتم قدمتم برهاناً على أن مشكلة الخصوصيات وهي أهم مشكلة تعاني منها البشرية الآن العلاقة بين الأنا وبين الغير أن هذه المشكلة يمكن أن يبحث لها عن حل البرهان لا بد أن يكون عملياً حتى نقنع الآخرين بأننا فعلاً كذلك كل الديانات تجد نفسها الآن في وضع أحياناً غير مريح الديانة الإسلامية أو المسيحية أو اليهودية قضايا الإجهاض قضايا يعني السلوكيات المختلفة في العالم الحديث التي نشأت عن فكرة الفردانية المستندة إلى الحرية فالديانات بخاصة تلك السماوية التي ترى أن الأخلاق تجيء من أعلاه وأنها لم تنبت من الأرض هذه الديانات في مرحلة التكيف التي ربما تكون مرحلة صعبة فالزيتونة هي محاولة جادة لإيجاد مقاربات إبداعي اقتراحي يسمح بالتعايش لأن السلم الاجتماعي هو مقصد أعلى ليس فقط بالنسبة للعقول وبالنسبة للمصالح ولكن أيضاً بالنسبة للديانات وبخاصة الإسلام الزيتونة تفهم أهمية السلم وبالتالي فإنها تسعى في هذا المجال وهو مجال فيه صعوبة كبيرة وهو التعايش بين أفكار مختلفة ورؤية للكون رؤى للكون مختلفة كيف ننمي المشتركات لنحيا جميعا بسلام على هذه الأرض على أساس لكم دينكم ولي دين وعلى أساس حلف الفضول التعاون في الخير والتضامن في مصالح العباد بحكمة وعدل ورحمة ومصلحة تلك المبادئ الأربعة التي تقوم عليها شريعة الإسلام أما البيان البيان هو أن تقدم شيئا بينا للآخرين هذا بيان من ربكم تبيانا لكل شيء لكن هذا البيان الذي نطق به الوحي أوكل الله مهمة تبيينه لنبيه فقال لتبين للناس ما نزل إليه لكن بقيت وسائل البيان جاء الشافعي وذكر خمسة أنواع من البيانات البيان الأول البيان الثاني الثالث الرابع إلى آخره ما معنى ذلك؟ الدين واحد والبيان القرآني واحد لكن مع ذلك الطرق تختلف والمضامين تختلف فلأجل هذا ذلك احتاج الأمر إلى بيانات تعددت مستوياتها وتنوعت مراتبها واختلفت درجاتها في هذا العصر نحن نحتاج إلى وسائل إيضاح جديدة لتقديم هذا البيان في العلاقة بين الواقع وبين الوحي مفهوما بالعقل البشري. كيف نقدم البيان في هذا العصر الذي يعتبر عصر الإنسان بكل ما تحمله كلمة الإنسان من نبل ومن أنانية ومن كل الصفات التي يحملها؟ برامج زيتونة التي اطلعت عليها وهي تبدأ بالكتاب وهو الحبل الواصل بين السماء والأرض، ثم السنة النبوية وهي البيان الأول، ثم علوم الفقه وما يتعلق به من عبادات ومعاملات، وهي عبارة عن الاجتهادات البشرية لفهم الوحي. الفقه وما يتعلق به من أصول وقواعد، ثلاثي الفقه يمكن أن نقول فروع وأصول وقواعد، ثلاثي اللغة مفردات وصرف ونحو، ثلاثي البلاغة بيان ومعاني، علم البيان وعلم المعاني وعلم البديع، المنطق وما يتعلق به. لكن المهم أيضا الذي هو خارج عن النسق هو أنها تقدم الدستور الأمريكي وتقدم دراسات عن التاريخ الأمريكي وتقدم دراسات مقارنة في الفلسفة. هذا نموذج الزيتونة الذي يريد أن يعيش مع العصر وهو يحمل حمولة الأصالة. لعلي أطلت عليك.
الله يبارك فيك سيدي.
تفضل.
So the next is the Burhan. So he talked about the name Zaytuna, and now the Burhan. In he said that Burhan is demonstrative proof, apodictic proof. It's the highest proof in logic. When you make an argument, there are different types of arguments. You have persuasive argument, poetic argument. The highest is using demonstrative proof. And he said this is why the Quran says that there's come a proof from your Lord. There's a demonstrative proof from your Lord. And also the Prophet ﷺ said, charity is a demonstrative proof of faith. In other words, it demonstrates faith and proves it. And so he said that when we look at the situation, there are some people who argue, for instance, that Islam is a problem. And then there are other people that are saying that it's a solution. So this needs proof. Both of these positions, these propositions, need proof to substantiate. So what is your proof? And he said that the biggest problem that we're facing today is the relationship between us and them, between the self and others, that this is really the fundamental problem that we're dealing with on the planet. And he said that all religions have problems, that if we look at any of the religions, we have problems. And they also have a problem with the age that we're in, because there are many things that go against the traditional beliefs and faiths of people. For instance, you have things like abortion and types of behavior that would be traditionally categorized as deviant behavior. That these problems are rooted in this modern concept of freedom, that people have freedom. And so he said that in the religious traditions, morality is believed to be something that actually is from heaven. It's something that is heavenly. And he said that Zaytuna really is in his mind, a serious project that's attempting to address some of these problems and wants to share in solving some of these problems. And if we look at our religion itself, peace is literally the highest priority of the religion. That in, if you look at the that our juristic tradition, it's always to remove strife, to remove problems of war and things like this. And he said that the problem of conviviality, of living together, of multicultural, pluralistic societies is a major problem because we have different peoples living in the same areas and we have different ideas, people carrying different banners. And he said, so how do we find these common denominators? How do we reduce these fractious conditions and find these common denominators so that we can join these factions or join these fractions together by finding these common denominators? He said that one of the ways for us is to understand that our religion is based on four, it has four foundational principles. It has the principle of wisdom. It's a religion of wisdom. And so if it moves to something other than wisdom, it's not from that religion. It's a, it has the principle of justice. And then it has the principle of this, the common weal of social good, of benefit. And then it, it's rooted in the principle of mercy, a universal mercy. So that's the proofs that we need to put forward. And he said, in terms of the bayan, the last one, which is clarity, that how do you clarify things? The Quran says that it's a clarification for all things. And the Quran also says that the Prophet ﷺ was sent to make things clear to the people about what was revealed to them. So how do you make these things clear? There, we have to understand there's a difference between clarity and the means to achieve clarity or to arrive at clarity. So Imam Shafi'i, for instance, argued that there were five types of clarification in the Quran. And those, even though the religion is one, the revelation is one, there are different ways in which the Quran makes things clear, in which the Prophet ﷺ makes things clear. And that's because people are different. You can't speak to everybody in the same way. You have to speak to different peoples in different ways. They need to be addressed according to their backgrounds, according to their understandings. One of the great challenges that we face today is the relationship between reality and revelation. Because we have a social reality that we're dealing with, and then we have a revelation. How do we understand revelation in light of our current reality using the medium of intellect, of intelligence? He said, this is the fundamental task of the Muslims, and that there are further complications when you realize that the human being is of a mixed yarn by nature. He has nobility and selfishness within his own two sides. So you're dealing with the complexities and the contradictions that we carry with us as human beings. But we have a tradition of threes, of triviums. And he said that the first is that your foundation here is on the book, the revelation, on the sunnah, the revelation of the person, and then on jurisprudence, on understanding the legal implications of these meanings that have been given to us. And then jurisprudence is further, it has another trivium. It has the branches, but then it has what is akin to constitutional law, is how the statute law comes out, how the legislation is derived from the philosophy behind the statutes. And then you have the qawaid, what are the foundational principles that you use to guide yourself in bringing about these laws. And then he said, and the means, the medium for this is language. And language in our tradition also is a trinity. It has the mufradat, which are the words that we use, their meanings, their definitions, and then grammar, and then morphology. And then he said, and then rhetoric also has three components to it. Rhetoric has the idea of metaphors and similes. It also has the idea of how one articulates the syntactical structures of rhetoric, and then it has what are called the embellishments of language. And these three components are studied under the rubric of rhetoric. And then finally, logic is also a triad. So you have the triad of logic because logic deals with propositions, with statements. Logic deals with first with concepts. And then it deals with statements, and then it deals with reasoning, how you take the concepts, you make propositions with those concepts, and then how you take those concepts, and then you reason through them to arrive at a new understanding. So this is really what is at the foundation and the root of this curriculum.
أخيراً أود أن أختم كلمتي هذه بالحث على معرفة النصوص وهي جواب ماذا قال ربك الحث على معرفة حكم الشريعة ومقاصدها وهذا هو الجواب على لماذا الحث على معرفة البيئة في هذه الديار والبيئة البشرية بصفة عامة لتنزيل الأحكام فيها وهو الجواب عن كيف إذن لا بد عن الجواب على ثلاث أسئلة ماذا لماذا وكيف هذا هو التحدي أمام مؤسستنا الكبرى الزيتونة لا تنسوا أنكم تمثلون شجرة من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية أي هي شرقية وغربية فأنتم تمثلون هذه الروح التي فهمت منها أنها روح تصالح روح تظل الشرق والغرب فنرجو أن تكون الزيتونة دائما مظلة كبرى يسعدني تنوع المواد وتنوع الأساتذة أيضا الذين يقدمون هذه المواد إنه عمل رائع إنه نموذج صالح اسمحوا لي أن أبشر قيادة الزيتونة بأنهم يقومون بعمل صالح لأنهم ينشرون العلم والعلم من العمل الباقي وأن أهنئ طلاب الزيتونة لأنهم يطلبون العلم ومن سلك طريقا يطلب فيه علما سبيلا يطلب سهل الله به له به سبيلا إلى الجنة وإن الملائكة لا تضع أجنحتها لطالب العلم رضا بما يصنع كما يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن أهنئ أولئك الذين قدموا المال للزيتونة لأنهم يقومون بعملين إذا مات ابن آدم انقطعه عمله إلا عن ثلاث إلا من ثلاث صدقة جارية والمال الذي يدفع إلى الزيتونة هو صدقة جارية وولد يدعو له صالح يدعو له بالخير وأبناء الزيتونة يمكن أن يكونوا بمنزلة هذا الولد الصالح وعلم ينتفع به فهذا المال الذي يقدمونه يقوم بهذه الوظيفة الثلاثية فهم يتركون صدقة جارية يتركون من يدعو لهم بالخير يتركون علما ينتفع به بعدهم فبشرى لهم بذلك وأرجو الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يتقبل منا ومن الجميع وأن تكون هذه الزيتونة نموذج وألتزم بترجمة نظامها وبتوزيع نظامها حتى يستفيد الناس منه ويفيدوا فإن الزيتونة هي نموذج حي نسأل الله أن يبقيه وأن يبقيكم جميعا في خير وبركة وأن يتقبل منا ومنكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
استناه وانتظروا حتى يقرأ
نعم جميل
So finally, Shaykh said he wants to finish by saying that there's three things that are very important for people at Zaytuna to know and learn. The first is the knowledge of the text that they're studying. And the first one is to know what the text actually says. So you have to know the answer to what. What does the text say? But then you also, the second one is you have to know the wisdom. What is the wisdom? In other words, why is the text saying that? So you know mada, and then you have to know lima, that why. So with the Quran, you can know what God said, but if you don't know why it's said, then you can misunderstand the application. And then finally, the last one is to understand the environment that the what and the why are realized in. And this is an answer to the question of how. How do we apply what we've learned, understanding why it's been given to us? How do we apply it in the conditions we find ourselves in? And these are very difficult to do, to apply them. And so he's saying that it's important to know these, to understand that you have to know the wisdom, you have to know what's being said and understand it clearly, know the wisdom, but then you have to know how to apply it appropriately to the time and place, because it's not the same application in different places. It's different applications for different places, and this is the whole purpose of ijtihad. And then finally he said that to remember that Zaytuna, like the Quran says, is neither of the East and the West. In other words, it's from both the East and the West. And that it has the spirit of the East and the West, the best of these two geographical positions in the world. He believes that it's a great work and it's a righteous work. And he reminded us of the hadith, the Prophet said, whoever sets out seeking knowledge, that God will make easy his path to paradise, and even the angels will lower their wings in humbleness to the seeker of knowledge. Even the whales in the oceans ask forgiveness for the seeker of knowledge. And then he also wants to conclude by thanking the people who financially supported this endeavor, because without you, the endeavor is not possible. And he said that the Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith, when a person dies, all of their actions are cut off except for three things that remain and they continue to derive benefit from them. And the first is a charity that has perpetuity, an endowed charity, a charity that goes on after they're dead. And then a righteous child that was raised that will pray for them. And finally, knowledge that people benefit from. He said that one of the beauties of this project is you get all three. Because when you give charity, you're maintaining the perpetuity of the institution. It's producing righteous children that will pray for the people that enabled them to study in that institution. And then it's perpetuating useful knowledge that will be of benefit. So that's a great good news for the people that are helping to support it.
And thank you for attention. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Alhamdulillah. One of the things that the I really want to, I know that Shaykh Abdallah, mashallah, he literally flew 16 hours and only had one day to adjust. So may Allah reward him, inshallah, and increase him for doing that. But the next thing that we're going to do, inshallah, the Prophet ﷺ had a seal, and it's the tradition to use seals historically. And so colleges around the world have seals. And so we're going to introduce our seal. And we debated long and hard over what to use as the school motto. And we ended up agreeing on the verse in the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا, and say, oh my Lord, increase me in knowledge. The reason that we chose this verse is because Zaytuna really is about increasing our knowledge to address the crises of knowledge in our society. So we're going to this is our seal. There's there's a tree in Turkey. Some of you may have visited it, over the grave of one of the righteous in Turkey, that literally spells Allah. And so that was the inspiration behind the tree of Zaytuna, having Allah in the branches. Now I'm going to, inshallah, introduce Dr. Colleen Keyes, who's our Dean of Faculty. He's really been an extraordinary addition to the Zaytuna family, to recite for us a poem on the occasion. Thank you.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This poem, called The Seven Sleepers, is by Mark Van Doren. Mark Van Doren was an American poet, editor, and critic, as well as scholar and professor of English for more than 40 years at Columbia University. This poem was chosen by Sheikh Hamza, and it has resonance in the Islamic tradition as well as the Christian tradition. For the Islamic tradition, the seven sleepers have to do with the seven sleepers of the cave in Surat Al-Kahf. The seven sleepers. The liberal arts lie eastward of this shore, choppy the waves at first, then the long swells and the being lost. Oh, centuries of salt, till the surf booms again and comes more land. Not even there, except that old men point at passes up the mountains, over which, oh, centuries of soil, with olive trees for twisted shade and helicons for sound. Then eastward seas, boned with peninsulas, then Orient, the islands, and at last the cave, the seven sleepers. Who will rise and sing to you in numbers till you know white magic, which remember, do you hear? Oh, universe of sand that you must cross, and animal the night. But do not rest. The centuries are stars and stud the way.
Bismillah, inshallah. Now we'll have three student speakers. So I'd like to introduce our three student speakers. Two student speakers, Faatimah and Zaid. I'm sorry, yeah. So I want to introduce now His Eminence, Professor Sayyid Hussain Nasir. I think most of you know him. He's really one of the intellectual giants of this country. His books have been translated into countless languages. He's influenced many, many scholars. In different fields, and some of his students are now some of the finest scholars of Islamic studies in the United States. So it's my honor to invite Dr. Hussain Nasir.
Rahim. I feel sorry for all of you. You're probably all very tired, and you wish I would shut up quickly. And had I not come all the way from Washington, I would be very glad to only speak for 2-3 minutes. But I'm to deliver the commencement address, and I'm sorry to have to take a few moments of your time, but this is a moment of beginning for those who graduate, and it's why, paradoxically, the end of college education is called commencement. And it's really the commencement of life. This is a very special occasion I believe in the history of Islam in America. That's why I had the honor really to accept to come here and speak to you, because this is the first educational organization, institution of higher learning, of both an Islamic character and devoted to the liberal arts. And this unique combination in America will, inshallah, one day bear a great deal of fruit. We must remember that when Harvard College was formed in 1636, just a few students accepted to be trained to become ministers of the Puritans so that they would not have to train the ministers back in England from which they had fled. And today, it's the university that it is. Perhaps one day, Zaytuna College will fulfill the same function for the Islamic community and perhaps the larger community in this country. My prayers are very much with both the organizers, the founders, the supporters, and the students and teachers of this institution. I'm very happy to have had something to do with it from the very beginning. When Shaykh Hamza Yusuf, my dear friend, and others, Shaykh Zakir, others came to see me in Washington to try to sort of pick my brain about how to create a college, Islamic college of higher education. This is one of the most important problems of the Islamic world today, the importance of the Islamization of the humanities, not to talk of the natural and social sciences in the Islamic educational system, which is facing such a crisis that even in countries which purport to be Islamic, most of the humanities are taught from the Western point of view. I myself was for 20 years professor of philosophy at Tehran University, the dean of the faculty for many years, university president in Iran. I tried to all these years, at least to try to have Islamic thought taught from the Islamic point of view, but 30-some years after the Iranian revolution in Iran, still the philosophy department of Tehran University is teaching mostly Western philosophy and looking upon Islamic philosophy from the Western point of view. So this is a major international issue for the Islamic world, and Zaytuna College is really a kind of pilot project that, if successful, I believe will have a very, very important effect upon the rest of the Islamic world, as well as the education of Muslims here in America and Canada and perhaps in Europe. In the traditional Islamic educational system, all education was related to the Islamic worldview, all education. Subjects from astronomy to grammar, from poetics and ethics to medicine and everything in between, were within a Weltanschauung worldview which was Islamic. It was not only tafsir, Quran, and hadith, and fiqh, that is purely religious subjects that we look upon the word religious today, that were Islamic, but the whole of the Islamic educational system. Now, foundational to the system was the religious sciences, but at the heart of the system was what we call today the humanities, and the closest word for that in Arabic is adab, which is a Pahlavi word from Middle Persian that entered into Arabic and became a very, very important term, and which does not only mean literature, but really means the humanities, as Western, English developed this term since the Renaissance. Such a thing did not exist in the same sense in the Middle Ages, the humanities. But including fields such as philosophy, history, the arts, literature, and so forth, because the human being, man and woman, really lives in this world mostly. Not all human beings are lawyers dealing with Islamic law, nor all are pure metaphysicians dealing with ma'rifah. Most of them deal with this intermediate world of the humanities, and so its Islamization is crucial to the preservation of the Islamic character of Islamic society, and for here in America, of the preservation of the identity of the Islamic community, which is a small minority at the present moment here. Our students now and those who come in the future should know that the Islamization of Islamic education, especially the humanities, even here in America, requires not one but two fundamental forms of knowledge. One is knowledge of the Islamic humanities or the liberal arts in an authentic manner. And secondly, knowledge of Western culture and the Western humanities, which now threaten the Islamic world itself. Now, both of these are very difficult to come by, surprisingly. As for the first, Islamic humanities, we deal with, let's say, Arabic grammar, that's not so difficult. But even in literary criticism, in both the Arab world and Iran, the two major languages of the Islamic world, much of the view is taken from the West. It's not purely Islamic. We even look upon our own literature from a Western point of view. Almost all modern histories of Arabic and Persian literature that are written really from the Western point of view. Somehow, magically, Arabic poetry becomes irrelevant after the Abbasid period. I don't know what the Arabs were doing the next 700 years, having so many wonderful poets, but they're not considered to be significant. And the Persian, almost the same thing, coming a bit later than in the 15th century with Abd al-Rahman Jami. You have this way that even the humanities, as taught in American or Islamic universities, even within the Islamic world, are not really taught from the Islamic point of view. And the same could be said for psychology, for philosophy, for even history. And so we have actually not a small task, we have a very big task of to learn our own humanities tradition from our own point of view. And believe you me, that's a very difficult task. The Islamic world has been very lazy intellectually in this field. I wrote about these matters 50 years ago, and I'm very sad that now that there's a crisis within my own country in Iran, and talk about Islamization of the humanities, of adab, they have to call me to write something for them again. I wrote something like that 50 years ago, and it's very sad that we have not really done what we should have done half a century ago when the confrontation with the West became imminent and evident to many Muslim intellectuals that woke up from the blindness of the early 20th century and the 19th century among the modernized classes. The second type of knowledge, the knowledge of the Western culture and Western humanities, seems to be easier. But it's, in a sense, even more difficult because the Western humanities are facing a major crisis within themselves, and the diversity of opinions and views as to the meaning of Western humanities proliferates remarkably. And it's not easy to have just one view of the Western humanities. France, which had been at the forefront of the philosophy of the humanities in Europe after the Second World War, has produced so many different philosophies, now ending up with deconstructionism, which tries to deconstruct literary texts and, in fact, destroy any absolute meaning, not only in sacred scripture, but also in human literature. These are not so easy to master because they are so salient and flowing, and they have no permanence. Thank God for that, because they're all false. But nevertheless, we have to master them. And to be able to master them also in such a way as not to be duped by them is one of the great challenges of the graduates of this college and every other Muslim who's trying to study the humanities in the West. Because one of the first things that is done usually for the PhD program, even in the best Western universities, is to whitewash the background from which the subject is taught in such a way that you think it's objective, but actually is to remove the views that might exist in the mind of students as to the meaning of the humanities other than that what is being taught in the different colleges. There's a very major crisis in the humanities in the United States, besides the fact that, as you know, as soon as there's an economic shortage, the budget of the Department of Mechanical Engineering is not cut. The first thing that is cut is the humanities. The humanities are the orphan child of Western universities. And it's very interesting, the Islamic world, all the ups and downs economically that went over the centuries, this was never the case. We do not have one case in which this type of teaching was excluded because the government was poor. You have never had even one case in 1,400 years of Islamic history. Now, with these comments in mind, I want to turn really to the graduate class specifically. Usually in commencement addresses, whoever's lecturing or talking tries to address the graduate students and give them some advice for life and so forth. Of course, those general advices for life are wonderful, but I want to be a bit more specific, because we're dealing actually with a unique institution, the first of its kind in North America, and it's wonderful to see all the efforts put through by Shaykh Hamza Yusuf and others, and now we see the first fruit of it, and inshallah it will be not the last, but the first of many, many wonderful graduating classes to come. So I have some advice that's addressed to them particularly, but to those who are in a similar situation like them in universities which are not Islamic universities. I still teach and have many, many students at the university where I teach who are Muslims and are pursuing similar careers, you might say, as what we find in Zaytuna. Although the institution where I teach is not an Islamic institution, it's a famous American university. But nevertheless, my comments pertain to all of these people, but more specifically to, of course, this graduating class. The most important and difficult thing is to continue to preserve the authenticity of your Islamic roots. And I would not mean only by that the daily prayers. That's very, very important, of course. I do not mean by that only Islamic ethics. That's also very, very important. But I mean by that also to preserve a mental ambience which is Islamic, in which the realities of Islam can be breathed, which is not alien to the Islamic worldview. And this is very difficult in a secular world, in which especially if you go to university, and the better university, the more powerful this force is to secularize the mind. So-called, they say, to take away its baggages. But the baggages are the baggages of sacred presence. They're not negative baggages. So all of you will be faced not only with the ordinary challenges in society of a secularized world, of people running after money, of all kinds of things being done which are against Islamic law and so forth, but intellectually to be challenged all the time to be a Muslim but not think Islamically. That is, American universities and British universities, and especially American universities within the Islamic world, like in Cairo, Beirut, and other places, are really carrying out without knowing it what Lord Macaulay wanted to do in India when he became the Viceroy of India, to train Indians who thought like the British, who followed the way of the British, but who were Indians. And they certainly have done a good job either before independence or after independence. It's not only in Muslim world, but in Hindu India. The training of people who are really uprooted intellectually is part and parcel of the great crisis that is to be found throughout the non-Western world. So to be rooted, I mean not only religiously, ritually, and ethically, but also intellectually and spiritually. Secondly, your path for the understanding of the Islamic humanity has not come to an end. It has only begun. The Islamic humanities is a vast, vast ocean. I'm at the end of my life, and I've been studying for the past 60 years. Probably everything I've got my hand on in Arabic and Persian, on philosophy, which is my own field, on history and literature and so forth. And I've just really scratched the surface. It's remarkable how vast, how rich the Islamic intellectual tradition is. And our ignorance of it doesn't make it disappear, doesn't make it to go away. It's your duty, I believe, to continue to educate yourself, no matter where you go from here, in the Islamic humanities. There are many linguistic barriers you will have to overcome. Some of you don't know how good your Arabic is, how good your non-Arabic Islamic languages is. In the field of humanities, Persian plays a very important role, not only in Persia itself, but in the Indian world and in the Ottoman world. Over 50% of the most important works in the humanities in the Ottoman world are in Persian, not in Turkish or Arabic. Very, very, very few in Arabic. Some in Turkish, but mostly in Persian. And the same for Muslim India. And you have to overcome these linguistic difficulties and enter into this vast ocean of the Islamic humanities. Thirdly, and this is very, very difficult, not to be dissuaded from your goal by the pressure of the secularist ambience around you. Secularism appeals to the ego. It appeals to a person saying, oh, you know, these people who are religious, are simple people, they're not intelligent. Come and be intelligent like us. This modern atheism that is coming out in England now, and associate people like Richard Dawkins and the like, they call themselves the brights. And they believe that those who believe in God are not bright. This is, of course, something demonic. In the philosophy of illumination, God is light, and those who believe in God have the light of God in them. But now it's been reversed, and those who do not have the light of God in them are called brights. And this appears to the ego of many young men and women, and you'll be confronted very, very strongly with this challenge. Fortunately, you've come half a century later than a person like myself. I was really the first generation of Muslims training the best American institutions, faced with the challenge of secularism at its highest level. I knew people like Bertrand Russell, the most famous atheistic philosophers of the day. I discoursed with them. I wasn't afraid. I wanted to get to the heart of the matter. I wasn't running away. Since then, of course, Muslims have provided many, many answers, and you're not alone. You're not alone. And Islam and Islamic thought and Islamic intellectuality has been able to hold its ground in contrast to what people thought 50 years ago. Fourthly, it's very important for you to study in depth the criticisms that are made in the West of secularism and modernism, and secularist humanities, philosophies, ways of thinking, and understand also in depth why so many people speak about the death of Western culture itself. It's not only a few poets like T.S. Eliot. There have been sociologists, philosophers who talk about this. It wasn't only Martin Heidegger, the famous German philosopher, who said, philosophy dies with me, I'm the last philosopher. Even Richard Rorty, the famous atheist, American philosopher, died a few years ago, talked about the end of philosophy. You must understand what this phenomenon means. Why is it that the West, which is so powerful in having drones in Afghanistan kill people in little villages, cannot answer fundamental questions pertaining to philosophy and the humanities in its own backyard? You must understand why this is happening. As I've said over so many years, the West produced Orientalists. With the Orientalism, they dominated over much of the Islamic world and tried to change the Muslims' understanding of their own religion. However, the Islamic world has had very great trouble training Occidentalists, that is, people who know the West well. The Orientalists were not people who knew the Islamic world and suddenly became Muslims. No, most of them were either atheists or Christians or Jews. But the Islamic world has a lot of people who know the West, but they're absorbed by the West. There's no Muslim knower left. The subject has been absorbed in the object. I don't mean that. I mean people who are Islamic in their identity, but to understand the West. We have very, very few people like that. But it's something necessary, absolutely necessary to cultivate, and especially people coming from a place like Zaytuna, they're destined by the hands of God, I believe, to play a very important role, because they can do this much more easily than someone going to the University of Punjab in Lahore, or Tehran University in Tehran, or some university in Kuala Lumpur or Jakarta. Fifthly, the new group of people who are now just beginning their intellectual life must understand they are like the avant-garde, except in a positive sense, the forerunners of what is happening. And they really must have the courage, the moral courage, to see themselves as leaders in a virgin and new field. It's not totally new intellectually, because we've already had the encounter with the West on many levels. When I faced the situation first 50 years ago, there was no one else, absolutely no one else, who spoke of these matters. Now we have many people. But nevertheless, as students, as a group of students coming from the institutions such as this, they are really people who are leaders in a virgin field. And they should have not fear, but tawakkul on Allah, the confidence upon God, and be self-confident that with His help, they shall be able to succeed. Sixthly, it's very important for the graduates of this class and also the future to keep in close contact with the Islamic world itself. This is not an island somewhere in San Francisco. Because of modern means of communication, everything is connected to everything. If I give a lecture here, 2 hours later, somebody in Jakarta is going to publish the summary in some paper. It happens all the time, every week in my life. Everything is interconnected. And it's very important for our students here, the kind of experience that they gain here in America, to be able to have a close rapport with the Islamic world to the extent possible. Much of the Islamic world is now in flames. One country after another is being destroyed. Great centers of Islamic civilization, like first Iraq and then Syria, have been decimated. We live in one of the most tragic periods in Islamic history. But I'm not that pessimistic. These are pains of transformation, and despite the machinations that are going on, better days will come. But in order for those better days to come, those who are given to the unity of the Islamic Ummah, to the authenticity of its message, and to the belief in the intellectual and spiritual power of Islamic thought and Islamic way of looking at things, they're the ones who will have the final word and the final say. And there's still many people in the Islamic world, even in countries where there is contention and conflict, who are intensely interested in the issues which I've just discussed here, in the Islamic humanities. I receive letters all the time from Kabul, just now being reconstituted after the wars in Afghanistan, of young Afghan scholars or students who write to me about these matters. And so the close contact between a small group of people here, which is numerically small, but qualitatively very significant, and the rest of the Islamic world is most important. Finally, of course, my last advice to you is never to forget that we only increase knowledge if God wills it. When the Prophet said, Ya Rab Zidni Alman, he was praying for the increase of knowledge. And that should be the prayer of all of you. And with the help, inshallah, you will inaugurate not only a new chapter in your life, but a new chapter in the life of the Islamic community.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. I want to begin today first by welcoming all of you in here with us, welcoming our guest speakers, congratulating our students, but more so congratulating the families, because it's really you who made it possible for trusting Zaytuna to send your best and brightest to enter into our doors and trust us with their ability to teach them at a time we were not credited. We did not have a room. We did not have desks. We had to run to IKEA to get some tables and desks for them in the first class. So really, the gratitude, it is to the families who believed in Zaytuna as an idea and really sent your students to us. I would like to quote Confucius and possibly say, why not someone else? But Confucius, who lived around the 6th century BC, had a statement that is profound and appropriate for this occasion, and what Zaytuna College's real mission and a sense of accomplishment today. But we have to put it in proper perspective. He said, if you think in terms of a year, plant a seed. If in terms of 10 years, plant a tree. If in terms of 100 years, teach the people. If you think about the mission and the goal of Zaytuna College, I would have to say that we are building institutions. And the Prophet ﷺ was the first to build an institution. In essence, if you want to build a society, you need to plan for 1,000 years plus. What we are celebrating today is an outcome of 1,435 years. Even longer than time itself, because time is a created element. Our road to Zaytuna starts not today with this important graduation, not in 2009, when we officially shifted from institute to college, nor was it with the founding of Zaytuna Institute in 1996, a blessed occasion indeed. This education of ours goes all the way back to Adam, and direct divine knowledge that was and is transmitted one prophet to another and from one generation to another. In our case, we are partaking in the transmission from our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from the first educational institution in Mecca, Darul Arqam. The Prophet's mosque in Medina to be followed, then on to Syria and Jerusalem, Baghdad's Dar al-Hikmah and the Nizamiya schools, Al-Qayrawan, Zaytuna University and Al-Azhar, Cordoba, Toledo, and Granada, to schools, seminaries, and madrasas in North Africa, Indian subcontinent, Timbuktu, Sudan, and Mauritania. We are, as a tradition, know how to build institutions, and this is our contribution to the world. Our first revelation was read, recite, repeat. Had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chosen any other magnanimous word to begin the last revelation with, he would have chosen it. And therefore, he chose for us read, recite, repeat. And therefore, our obligation as a society, as a community, as a religion, to be those who are entrusted with knowledge. All knowledge, sacred knowledge indeed, but all knowledge. And this is what we have done in the past. And inshallah, with Zaytuna and with our graduates, we will do in the future. Now, our graduation today is about Islam having an academic address in America. But with our new 9 graduates, Islam will have 9 new addresses that came out from Zaytuna College. Islam in America is as old as the country, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise. And we have been in these lands from the beginning, and most often coming in the holds of ships as cargo, than free men and women. But despite the darknesses of the journey and the hundreds of years passing, God had a different plan, and we are today part of that plan. Islam emerged again in the late 19th century and early 20th century. After known research that 10 to 20% of all the slaves that were brought to America were of Muslim background. And therefore, as Islam is reborn again in the 20th century among African-American communities, but following also a large number of immigrants that came thereafter. Therefore, Islam in this country is about linking the indigenous Muslim with the immigrant Muslim to make something magnanimous. Not something that is different than what happened in Medina. Al-Muhajirun wal-Ansar. Today, Zaytuna is about building a Muhajirun and Ansar community that will change and alter the perspective in this country. The French poet Victor Hugo correctly observed that, quote, he who opens a school door closes a prison. We are committed to closing prisons in this country. We are opening the prisons we construct in our own minds first and foremost. I do need to remind all of us today that we have the highest prison population anywhere in the world. We have the highest prison population anywhere in the world. More of it is black and brown, with 2.5 million people, including a sizable number of Muslims. How many Malcolm X are locked up because of structural racism? And how many of these would be Zaytunas if we unlock these prison cells? Instead of building 23 new prisons in the state of California, we should be building 23 new Zaytunas every day. Zaytuna will be able to embrace and unlock physically the prison cells, but it is our mental minds that we need to unlock. As the statement that I often repeat of Stephen Biko, the most dangerous weapons in the hands of the oppressor is the minds of the oppressed. It's the mind of the oppressed. And what we say, the most dangerous weapons in the minds of those who disbelieve in Islam is our own minds, because we make it possible for them to distort our understanding by our own action. Speaking about Boko Haram, they are haram in their understanding of Islam, and we need to remind everyone that about this particular aspect. We opened the college based on a vision, and a number of students responded to the possibilities contained in the promise to ground them in the Islamic tradition and being conversant in the contemporary cultural currents shaping our modern world, while making sure that they are morally committed leaders and pioneers in their future fields of choice. Our task is no less than to rethink education and its purpose in the modern world. As education has become a commodity, the college and university a corporate training and economic replacement parts, an ethics of not getting caught divorced from moral purpose, and an education rooted in injustice rather than justice and social justice, then Zaytuna education is a humble attempt at changing the course of our own contemporary history and reconnect us collectively to Adam as the first student that was guided and directed to manifest divine purpose and mercy in this world. Our prophet described himself as a teacher. The role of a teacher is to inspire, to awaken in the student the desire to think and explore. And in the words of Socrates, I cannot teach anybody anything. I can only make them think. What we did in Zaytuna over the past 4 years, we had students that came trusting in the vision of the institution, trusting in Imam Zayd, Sheikh Hamza, and myself. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our deed. And if we did something wrong, we ask forgiveness from him for what we have undertaken. But we were sincerely committed to making the students think. We did not want to make copies of us. We wanted each one of them to be a leader on their own, because our community needs 1,000, if not 1,000,000 leaders. It is my honor and privilege to introduce two of our future leaders, if not leaders today. Chris Cusano came to our institution already with a degree, but he is committed to being the leader that he wants to be. I would like to introduce him to speak, as well as Faatimah Knight with her family, and both of their families on here. I'd like to introduce him to speak so you could see the leaders that they are, and may Allah give them the guidance and tawfiq and open many doors for them in this world and grant them a high upward in paradise. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Good afternoon. Assalamu alaikum. And thank you for all joining us today on this momentous occasion. I've been asked to say a word, particularly of my experience, and I will, inshallah, but not without recognizing that there are others here who have more storied personal experiences than myself. One who, by the grace of God, is here with us today, despite obstacles that would have been likely unsurmountable for many of us, and myself in particular. And Sheikh Hamza made mention of this. I know his family isn't physically here with him today, but you all, his family, have all the reason in the world to be proud of what your son, Jamie Ford, has accomplished. I remember arriving here one night during the first week of Ramadan, August 18th to be exact, almost 4 years ago. I landed at SFO, crossed the bay with my first of what would be many experiences using the BART, alighted at the downtown Berkeley station, and proceeded to hike what had felt like a 5-mile uphill walk to my new home. Personal item in tote, 2 check bags trailing in tandem, and a carry-on MacGyvered to ride caboose. I still hadn't had iftar, and it was now about 3 a.m. on the East Coast from where I had left. I literally had to stop at least 3 times on the way out of pure fatigue. But I gathered myself, had at it again, and eventually made it, alhamdulillah. And that's how it's been. That's how this journey has been at Zaytuna. It's been difficult, and it's taken a lot of time to, at moments, take yourself and reflect on what it is you're doing and get back to work. And here I am, and more importantly, here we are, the rest of the students of Zaytuna College, 4 years later. Not everyone who started finished, and thus, this has been even more of a reason for myself to realize how much of a blessing it is to be here. Many circumstances out of our control made this impossible for some people. When you realize that, you know that this is from Allah, and ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَن يَشَاءُ Wallahu dhu fadlin azim. This is the bounty of God, which he gives to whom he wills, and God is the possessor of great bounty. At the same time, it was no easy task for anyone here, and it wasn't meant to be, but it was immensely rewarding. Rewarding to be seeking sacred knowledge, rewarding to have known and been the students of an esteemed faculty, an all-star lineup, if I may, and rewarding to be a part of this historic project of Zaytuna College. And so the proverbial student torch is passed on. Have you, the true torchbearers are still quite eloquently carrying the real torch. To the remaining classes, the remaining 40 of the 49ers who have comprised the first full group of students to migrate here to San Francisco Bay in search of a golden knowledge bequeathed unto us by our teachers in a chain that begins with our Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Archangel Gabriel, and God Almighty. And let me tell you, the gold is here. It may take some digging, then some smelting, and eventually molding, some of which the individual will be continuously tasked with into the future. But don't be mistaken, there's gold in California. Graduation is often called commencement because this marks the so-called beginning of your life. Maybe the beginning of your adult life or professional life, or maybe just the beginning of the rest of your life. But every moment, by definition, is the beginning of the rest of your life. If there ever was a moment to truly mark a beginning in that sense, it would be either birth, the beginning of this life, or death, the beginning of the next life. Which is all true. But if this is to be a commencement, we have to identify it as the beginning of something. If we students don't know what that something is by now, we might have missed the train. But I know we do. It's the beginning of a life of learning. I can hear my family now, and probably the family of others, oh no, here we go again, back to school. I'm not going to confirm or deny that, but let me say this. Learning takes both place inside and perhaps more importantly outside the classroom. It takes place through reading, through experience, through trials and tribulations, through family and friends, and through your teachers. Some of us may go on to pursue higher education. Some of us will enter careers as activists. And some of us will become full-time teachers of our children. No matter where we go, though, we should not and cannot fail to learn what God teaches us through it all. I don't want to take up any more of your precious time today. I just want to take the opportunity to thank my family for supporting me through this. Even if it may have seemed like not like a wise choice at the outset, I promise you it's been worth it. If I could do it again, I would. In fact, I've already submitted my financial aid application for next year, which Dua can attest to, but I'm pretty sure they denied me. I want to thank my wife and her family who has been patient and supportive of me through this adventure. The families of every student here need to be thanked and praised for their sacrifices as well. I want to thank everyone here at Zaytuna, everyone who has worked here or even just passed through the halls and blessed us with your presence. It is a special place because of you. And all of us need to especially thank every one of our professors who have been teachers of academic subjects, life in general, and so much more. We are forever indebted to you, and may God reward you. And finally, all the thanks and praises due to God, for he is the reason for all of us being here. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim wa akhira da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum. Okay. would like to begin by thanking Shaykh Abdallah Bin Bayyah for his presence here, which is quite literally, for us, a dream come true. I would also like to thank Dr. Nasir, who has inspired generations. And of course, our co-founders, Sheikh Hamza, Imam Zaid, and Dr. Hatem, who have enriched my life greatly. I stand here before you deeply humbled by the caravan of time which has led me to this day. I know with painful and fulfilling certainty that 4 years have come and gone since I started my journey here. This affair of ours, the class of 2014, is returning to God from whence it came. There are not enough moments in the day with which to thank God for all the joy he has blessed me with, no matter how fleeting, and whatever sadness too, no matter how prolonged, and all the subtle and profound blessings I have received and witnessed over these past 4 years and my whole life, truly. Oh, the things I would do if I could go back. I would rise earlier to read and to think. I would stay up later to talk and to feel. I would listen more closely and really allow the words to shake me. Most of all, I would try more earnestly to cultivate an open heart so I could benefit from all the blessings, both manifest and hidden, in the myriad forms they came in of people, books, and more. I know now that whatever osmosis may happen in which the good of a place becomes the good inside of you, my individual transformation is proportional to how much I want and allow myself to change. I want to tell you about some of the lessons my heart and mind have been able to receive during my time here. We are here, I have learned, trying to create the closest things to heaven. If we're not, then I hardly see the point of living. Heaven is a place where questions are answered, truth is evident, seekers eventually find, and the greatest teacher of all, God, is constantly available. It's where every student should want to be. It's the idea every scholar and friend of God has tried to actualize in whatever small or large way they could in this life, sacred harmony and rhythm. More than that, however, heaven is a place where pettiness has no home, and love, as we all know it should, conquers all. I have been taught heavenly lessons here. We live in a world in which the safest option is often disguised as the most risky. We read about this all the time in the Quran, and we see it in our own lives and others. People who hold onto this world for dear life because it's more tangible than faith sometimes, and the payout seems to come quicker than virtue and doing what's right. People say the class of 2014 took a huge risk in choosing to attend Zaytuna College, but I can tell you today that this was the safest choice I ever made. I invite you to bracket your notions of risk and think critically about what risk really is. All of my concerns in choosing to attend Zaytuna revolved around short-term risks, but all of my other options for school only promised short-term success. Zaytuna promised to be an abode of religion and truth-seeking. I had to ask myself, what was safer for me in the long term? Safer for my piety and my relationship with God, safer for my intellectual curiosity. And I found that Zaytuna was the only place that could begin to address my true need. As I face the end of this journey and the beginning of another, I wonder if I will ever feel as safe as I do here. But I feel adequately fortified intellectually and spiritually to critically and compassionately engage an ever more confusing world. Zaytuna started teaching me one of the greatest lessons of my life then, before I even walked in the door. A meaningful life results from small acts of bravery, bravery in the way we think and feel. Zaytuna taught me to prioritize my values over my expectations. These are some of the benefits of a liberal arts Muslim education. So I wish to suggest to you on this lovely California day that true risk is sacrificing a chance to please God in order to please another, not knowing if God will give you another chance. Risk is choosing the seemingly easier road while being convinced your contentment awaits you down a different path. Risk is staying the same, because staying the same is comfortable, when before you lies the option to be more fulfilled than you've been. Risk is letting your life pile up with regrets while you do the things that people expect of you, but not what you've grown to expect of yourself. I knew risk when, 4 years ago, deciding what college I would attend, I felt my soul begging me not to send it to a secular institution. A secular institution that could not care for it properly, and I cried over what might become of me. 18 is a very impressionable age. My parents have always told my sisters and I that we should feel empowered to do even better than they have as parents. I have been similarly empowered by the professors here, and I believe that an attitude like that will change the world for the better, because it's unselfish, and it values other people enough to allow them the space to act, so that they may be better than us or do better than us. And if we're honest, we often don't want people to do better than us or be better than us. However, we should remember that people wrapped up in themselves make for small packages, and there is always that possibility for someone to surpass us, so we might as well help them along the way. I often find it strange how the world moves on without me, and I'm sure you do too. It's not a mistake though, it's by design. So I pray for the class of 2015, 2016, and 2017, and all the classes to come, that you all far surpass me and my class in spiritual and intellectual excellence, but I pray that we have something worth surpassing. My sister once told me that when God opens a door of good for you, walk through it. That wisdom is what nudged me here. God opening a door for you does not mean that he has also laid out a red carpet, granted you an audience, and leveled out the road in front of you, although sometimes he does do that. It just means he opened the door, and there's blessing to be found there, even if as soon as you walk through the door, you trip on something. I came here at 18, I had habits to break, patterns to unlearn, beliefs to reconsider. I leave here at 22, and I still have habits to break, patterns to unlearn, and beliefs to reconsider. The difference is now I know what many of those habits, patterns, and beliefs are, whereas before, I may have been so ignorant of them that I could not even begin to get to the real work of rectifying them. The difference is now I have some answers, and I see for myself as a spiritual and intellectual being a world of possibilities, and I see that world of possibilities for us all. Thus, this ceremony is appropriately called a commencement, and finally, I give myself permission to begin living a life of more meaning, purpose, and courage, as my teachers taught me I should. Thank you, may God bless our Prophet.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima. By the authority of the Board of Trustees and with the recommendation of the faculty, Zaytuna College hereby confers the Bachelor of Arts degree on the class of 1435 in the Hijrah of our Prophet and of 2014 in the Common Era.
It is now my pleasure to introduce the graduates. Will the class of 2014 please rise? Sayyid Mahdi Amin was admitted to Zaytuna after having already graduated from law school. With a JD under his belt, he was admitted to the college with advanced standing and took upwards of 7 classes per semester in order to stand here today with the first graduating class. While discussing course load one day in my office, he complained not about too much work, but about too much spare time. At that moment, the seed of a college honors program was planted. In this and many other ways, these individuals have not merely been students, but also builders of Zaytuna College. From Chicago, Illinois, graduating summa cum laude, Sayyid Mahdi Amin. Christopher Cusano put himself through 4 years at Zaytuna while working almost full-time to pay the bills. Chris had already earned a master's degree in economics prior to enrolling at Zaytuna in the fall of 2010. His senior thesis on Islamic economics, bitcoins, and the cryptocurrency revolution drew on the strengths of his prior studies. Chris's research led him to conclude that although bitcoins and other cryptocurrencies are permissible, their potential impact will be destabilizing, quote, for better or for worse, end quote. Perhaps he chose those words because, for richer or for poorer, Chris got married last year. The couple will be moving to Chicago to begin their life together in the Windy City. We wish you well. From Trinity, Florida, graduating magna cum laude, Christopher Cusano. James Ford followed the development of Zaytuna Institute into Zaytuna College while an undergraduate at Columbia University, where he completed his first bachelor's degree. Hailing from an Ivy League institution, James still wanted more, and the tug of Islam drew him to Berkeley. In his 3rd year of study, James was hit by a car while riding his bicycle through the streets of San Francisco. After enduring months of hospitalization and dozens of reconstructive surgeries, James Ford has taught us what no classroom could, that life is delicate, time is precious, wa sabrun jameel. When that is the fruit, then the degree of knowledge is indeed the highest of degrees. From Cocoa, Florida, graduating magna cum laude, James Ford. Given to reflective silence, Harun Imtiaz's work at Zaytuna has culminated with an essay on liberal education that begins with Aristotle and the Lyceum in Athens and ends with Zaytuna College in Berkeley. Harun recognizes that there is a crisis in modern academic institutions, a crisis of purpose that stems from a corporate love of money and bureaucracy, emphasis on vocation rather than cultivation of the self, and philosophical disarray through the fragmentation of knowledge. In the second part of his essay, Harun argues, quote, the only way to combat such egregious indecency is to return to a universal understanding of man as a moral, rational, and spiritual being, end quote. May it be so. From Sterling Heights, Michigan, Harun Imtiaz. Reem Javed has been as much a junior colleague as an undergraduate student. In her time at Zaytuna, Reem naturally adopted the role of mentor and advisor to some of the younger students. Her sincere counsel to all sectors of the college, her courage, and her commitment to excellence and accountability has been an example for us all. One of the principles we live by at Zaytuna is that we are all students, including the faculty, at different stages of learning. Reem embodies that spirit, the spirit of seeking knowledge from the cradle to the grave, to which we all aspire. Graduating summa cum laude, Reem Javed. Faatimah Knight, or as Imam Zaid always calls her, Faatimah Knight in shining armor, gave up a spot at the University of Chicago to join Zaytuna College's inaugural class. Fatima's creative writing skills were displayed in our logic class, where she developed a dialogue between Plato and his imaginary daughter on the purpose of man. Her senior thesis, entitled Marriage and Maidens, Definition and Discovery, involves a bold and sophisticated inquiry on the representation of women in classical Islamic texts. It has been adopted as one of the required readings in a seminar at the Witherspoon Institute in Princeton this August, where she is going for an internship this summer before heading to Chicago for graduate studies. From Brooklyn, Illinois, from Brooklyn, New York, Faatimah Knight. When I first arrived at Zaytuna and we were deliberating which student should be asked to speak at the fall convocation, Mahasin Muhsin's name was enthusiastically offered and embraced. I had not met her yet, but a lasting impression had already been made. At the convocation, Mahasin informed the incoming class of 2015 about the Mabadi Ashara, 10 foundational elements that traditional scholars described before entering into the study of any subject. Mahasin, however, developed Mabadi not for a subject, but for Zaytuna College. In a sense, she can now add her name to one of the categories, Thamarat, herself being a fruit of this blessed tree. Graduating cum laude from Trenton, New Jersey, Mahasin Muhsin. Rashida Plenty was a poet and scholar in her own right before coming to Berkeley. She deepened her appreciation of language and poetry at Zaytuna by writing her senior thesis on the metaphor of archery in the Diwan of Imam al-Shafi'i. Entitled Aiming High, the project captures a sense of her soul. Rashida's lasting contributions to the college have been through her leadership at the Student Union. Among more significant structural changes, she also established traditions, including the reading of the khutbah of Abu Bakr when new officers are sworn in, a tradition she established when she assumed the office of president last year. Rashida will be joining Zaytuna's summer Arabic faculty before moving on to a PhD program at the Graduate Theological Union with a presidential scholarship, their most prestigious award to incoming students. From Kansas City, Missouri, graduating summa cum laude, Rashida Plenty. There is a sense at Zaytuna that we don't simply study history, We are its architects. We don't merely transmit tradition. We partake of it in our daily lives and shape what will be the tradition of tomorrow. There will be no class for which these words may ring truer than for you, the first graduating class in the history of Zaytuna College. Our final graduate, in alphabetical order, is Lina Safi. If students could be characterized by emotions, Lina's would be one of joy. Regardless of the day or the circumstance, Lina forged on, always with a smile. She now has been admitted not to one, but three graduate programs, and to one of these, the Chicago Theological Seminary, with their top merit scholarship. From Sterling Heights, Michigan, Lina Safi. Please join me in congratulating one more time the class of 2014.
سائرة تنتقي حار غواطيس الهاجر الحار صلي وسلم دائما أبدا Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidil Mursaleen. Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa salim tasliman kathira. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Those of you, some of you, are familiar with baseball. And if you're a historian of the game, you know that 2 weeks after Lou Gehrig was referred to as the Iron Man, the man who never missed a game, contracted the disease that would come to bear his name, Lou Gehrig's disease, that would soon take his life. He stood before the assembled throng at Yankee Stadium, and he said that he's the luckiest man alive. And then he proceeded to mention the ways that he had truly been blessed in spite of his disease. They say it's better to be lucky than to be good. But I think as Muslims, we would say it's better to be blessed than to be lucky. And I've been blessed to be a part, a small part, of the incredible journey that these wonderful students, each and every one of them, have taken. What a blessing. What a great, great blessing to have the opportunity to share the lives of so many courageous, strong, intelligent, visionary young people. Let's give them all another rousing round of applause. Before we conclude today's event with a prayer for them, the two orders of business. First, we'd like, gives me great pleasure to announce that Mrs. Safare Ozukur, who is the daughter of His Excellency, His Eminence, the Foreign Minister of the State of Turkey, Ahmet Davutoğlu, has honored our college by granting a yearly scholarship fund for Zaytuna College graduates. The fund will fully finance, fully sponsor one graduate each year to pursue their postgraduate studies at Istanbul University. Opening the doors for Zaytuna students to have the opportunity to benefit from Turkey's rich intellectual tradition. This year, any graduate interested in research studies related to the prophetic tradition and environmentalism will have the generous financial support of Mrs. Safari. Zaytuna College is honored for this partnership and thanks Ms. Safareh and her noble family for this wonderful, wonderful opportunity they're providing to our graduates. The second order of business, as was mentioned, this program was preceded by the seminary program of the then Zaytuna Institute. Perhaps some of those graduates who did the equivalent of 187 credit hours a year. We're not going to call on any names, in that they never had the opportunity to be honored as we honor these wonderful students today. We just want to recognize that these students understand that they're standing on your shoulders just as you stood on the shoulders of those who preceded you at Zaytuna Institute. So for any of them who are present and all of those students who passed through the gateway at 631 Jackson Street in Hay El-Ward, Hayward, California, let's give them a rousing applause. Again, we thank His Excellence Shaykh Abdallah Bin Bayyah and His Excellence Dr. Sayyid Hussain Nasir for taking the time from their busy schedules to be a part of this historic occasion, overcoming the rigors of travel to be here with us. Let's give them a very, very warm round of applause. So I ask everyone in the assembly, students, faculty, staff, supporters, donors, parents, well-wishers, let us pray for these wonderful, wonderful young people. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalat wassalam ala Sayyidi al-Mursaleen. Sayyidina wa Habibina wa Rasulina wa Nabiyina wa Kurrati Ayunina Muhammad. وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا الله والله. We pray that you bless these graduates to never belittle the magnitude of what they have accomplished here, but that you bless them and that you bless them to strive with might and main for greater accomplishments yet. We pray for these young people that they will never shy away from the call of greatness, but that they respond to that call with humility and grace. We pray that they will always allow the light of God to illuminate their path, and that they will be themselves shining stars who will serve as guides to others whenever darkness envelops the world. We pray that they will never hesitate to redress the wrongs they see, but that they will do so, be blessed to do so, with a heart free from rancor, far removed from wrath and rage. We pray that they will be unto all creatures a source of mercy, and that they will never ever themselves be distanced from the mercy of God. We pray that the sacrifices they have made and the hardships they have endured will make the trail which they have blazed a little smoother from those who will follow in their giant steps.
May Allah Ta'ala bless them, bless you, bless all of your families and loved ones. May Allah Ta'ala bless Zaytuna College, its faculty, students, staff, and all of its supporters. May Allah Ta'ala bless this gathering, bless our nation, bless our world. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Let us conclude by jointly reciting in one voice the Fatiha.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين.
تكبير 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 تكبير. الله أكبر ولله الحمد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Please be seated for the recessional and remain seated until the last member has left the auditorium.
شرفت العوالي جئت شرفت